Well, hello there, everybody. Welcome back to the channel of what should be the final episode of the Chicago Bears franchise. We've reached the end of the road. And before hopping into this season 3 slash series recap, I do want to talk about some quick housekeeping things, as the channel's obviously hit 60,000 subscribers. That happened last weekend. I was planning on doing a video for 60K, but I'm like, yeah, let's just save it for 100K. We'll get there at some point. But I really just wanted to take the moment to thank all of you. It doesn't matter how long you've been here. If you've been here since like the quarterback Road to Glory series at Missouri, or you just subscribed yesterday, thank you for your support. And I hope you guys stick around, because we've got some things planned for later this year. But obviously, moving back to the Bears franchise, we go 19-0. We win the Super Bowl. I'd say things improved pretty well. We went from, what, 3-13 the year before the Bears franchise started, to 5-11 to 10-5-1, and then eventually 19-0. Of course, led by Mitchell Trubisky, 3,600 yards, 24 touchdowns, 10 interceptions. The run game, Freddie Finnelis, the rookie out of UCLA. I wish I had more time, but unfortunately, this will be the end of the road for Finnelis' journey. Nearly 1,800 yards rushing, 20 touchdowns. What a season for the Rook. A big-time steal in the second. And speaking of stealing, in the second round, Carol Collins. 1,000-yard year for him, 7 touchdowns. Not too shabby. Left the team this season. Adam Shaheen, Cameron Meredith, Paul Richardson had a bit of a quiet year after leading us last year in receiving yards. Moving on to the front line, which was great in the run game, but unfortunately, Trubisky was sacked 54 times this year, and most of those coming off the right side from Kasheem Douglas, who was our fifth round selection back in year one. Obviously, he developed really well, and we're a little frustrated with the production, but then again, that's just Madden 18 acting up. On to the defense, Adrian Amos leads the team in tackles with 104, but solo tackles led by Bennett Cooper with 51. Moving down the board, Henry Wong had 22 this year. He was sidelined for a little time towards the end of the season. Deshaunta White and Henry Wong lead the team in tackles for a loss with 13 apiece. Deshaunta White was pretty big this year. And talk about being pretty big this year. 15.5 for White, 14.5 for Porton, 12.5 for Henry Wong, Marlon Humphrey 7.5. I mean, how much fun was this defense to watch this year? We've put together a pretty solid defense over these past couple years, and of course, a lot of that pressure led to a lot of interceptions. Rodriguez Beasley led the team in all rookies with 7 this season. Beasley also led the team with 7 pass deflections, Fuller with 6, Amos with 5. On to fumbles. We forced a lot of fumbles this year, and I'm happy to say that we recovered most of them. Not all of them, but we got pretty close. Pierre Stevens-Howling with 3, Henry Wong with 3, Bennett Cooper and a lot of other guys with 1. Safeties this season, Pierre Stevens-Howling, Henry Wong, and Russell McIntyre with 1. And defensive touchdowns, 3 for Pierce, 2 for Humphrey, 1 for Henry Wong, 1 for Bennett Cooper, 1 for Beasley, and 1 for Donald. Here's your kicker of the year for the second straight year in the NFC. TJ Cartwright went 30 of 32. Longest kick was 58 yards. And Pat O'Donnell, Pro Bowler once again. Absolutely crazy. 53 punts, 22 inside the 20. Only 12 touchbacks, and longest punt was 79 yards. Not too shabby. Jeremy McNichols, 3 returns this year. 1 taken back for a 98-yard touchdown, which was a bulk of the yardage that came in week 17. That was the only special teams return score this season. Unfortunately, Tariq Cohen was hurt and didn't do much. On to the league leaders, Aaron Rodgers, nearly 5,000 passing yards this year. He also led the NFL in touchdowns with 37. Interception leader this year, Marcus Mariota. Aaron Rodgers with 21 right behind him, so obviously that is not a great number. As far as starting quarterbacks go, Matt Ryan leads in completion percentage and QBR. Just couldn't make the plays when it mattered in the postseason. Talking about sacked quarterbacks, Dalton, your top sacked quarterback, and Luck and Trubisky tied in second at 54. On to the running game. Todd Gurley had the most carries this year at 366, but was 200 yards behind Freddie Finnelis, only at 295. So obviously Finnelis had quite a good year, 20 touchdowns, leads the NFL. Finnelis also leads the NFL in yards per game, 112.4, ahead of Freeman, 109.4. He didn't play the entire year. Unfortunately, Trubisky leads the NFL in fumbles with 9. A lot of those sacks led to near turnovers, and your longest carry this year goes to Tariq Cohen, who had a 97-yarder against the Eagles, I believe, earlier this year. On to the wide receivers. Randall Cobb led in receptions, 106, but Julio Jones with 1,400 yards, 1,432 to be exact, led the NFL. Chase Spencer leads the NFL in yards per game, although I would have to give it to Julio because Chase didn't play the entire year. Touchdown reception leader Dez Bryant, who is, I believe, hitting free agency this year. Julio Jones leads in rack run after catch, which is pretty impressive. Longest catch, Michael Crabtree somehow went 100 yards, and I don't know who that was against, but that team deserves an L. So while Kasheem Douglas gave up 16 sacks this year, I would really hate to be a quarterback depending on Garrett Bowles or Eric Flowers, who somehow sells a job. That would be incredibly bad. Moving on to defense, your solo tackle leader this year, and obviously when games are simulated, they don't do these very well, but Quan Alexander, 133. Damon Snacks Harrison led in tackles for a loss. Aaron Donald, 21 sacks this year. Incredible. He also had 73 solo tackles, which is unbelievable. Janoris Jenkins and Chris Harris Jr. had 9 interceptions apiece, which lead the NFL. Matt Bryan, again, continues to be one of the more accurate kickers in the NFL, going 23 of 24. Dan Bailey, 19 of 20 for 95% as well. But your longest kick this year goes to TJ Cartwright, who landed a 58-yarder. And his only misses came from blocks. I mean, that's not bad. On to the punt squad, Brad Nortman led the NFL in punts with 79, but did not lead in average. That goes to Pat O'Donnell, 52.1. O'Donnell tied with Marquette King at 44.5 for net, and leading in punts inside the 20 at 22, Vogel the closest at 15. Kick return touchdowns this year, 3-4 second-year receiver Bradley Orr of the Buffalo Bills, and a lot of punt return touchdowns, no one with more than one. On to team numbers, the Chicago Bears trending upwards in almost every category. 8,100 total yards, 62-16 offensively, 34.3 points per game, not a bad season. The Green Bay Packers lead in total yards at 8,200, and the Cleveland Browns at the bottom of the board, offensive yards leader, Atlanta, 67-70. And again, at the bottom of the board, just cresting over 5,000 is the Cleveland Browns. Pass yards leader, Aaron Rodgers, and the Green Bay Packers, 49-43. And the least goes to the Eagles. Bears near the bottom of the board. But if you look at the run numbers, there goes Chicago. One of the big goals for this team was to reestablish that power run game and get this defense put together. I think we did that pretty well. And there are the Saints with only 1,300 rush yards this season. Points per game, Chicago leads at 34.3. And the Panthers, pretty bad year for Cam Newton and those boys in Carolina. Texans lead in pass touchdowns. Browns are the worst at only 15 this season. And if you look at the rush touchdowns, Falcons 34, which is pretty surprising, although they did go 15-1. I'm not too shocked. And the Bengals at the bottom, only 9 rushing touchdowns combined as a team. That's not very good. On to the Bears defense. Let's talk about these new monsters of the midway. Chicago only giving up 3,998 total yards on defense this year, 170 points. And look at all these other numbers. If you look at total yards allowed, the Colts are the worst, 64-66. Raiders, Jaguars, surprisingly. But here are the Bears, under 4,000. Falcons, the second closest at 5,025. Your pass yards given up, leader, the Raiders, 47-36. The least, the Bears, 26-78. The Jets, surprisingly, second best at 34-63. Falcons in third place. Rush yards allowed, 2,100 by the Bengals. Again, the Bears at the bottom of the board, 1,320 this season. Atlanta, close second. The Lions, the worst team when it comes to points allowed, 505 points given up, and the Bears, 170, leads the NFL. Fun fact here, this Chicago Bears team has never trailed in any game that we have played this year. We've had tie games at kickoffs. We've had occasional exchanged field goals here and there to kick games off, but once our defense gets settled, good luck. Buccaneers are worst team when it comes to quarterback sacks, and the Bears at the top of the board at 76. Fumbles recovered, Panthers, the worst. Chargers, the best. Interceptions, the Dolphins, the worst. Where is Tywan Harden when you need him? And the Bears and the Broncos tied for first place when it comes to interceptions at 26. On to conversions. The Bears, 95 of 190 on third downs, 50%. Obviously, it could have been better, but we're kind of near the middle of the board. Broncos at 43%. The Titans at 56% were like smack dab in the middle. I think the only good thing you could say is this team didn't have a lot of third downs because we were scoring pretty consistently. On to the red zone, Chicago, 89% on offense and 72% on defense. Both of those numbers moving in the right direction. Offensively, at 89%, we lead the NFL, 58 trips, 35 touchdowns, 17 field goals. Would love to turn some of those field goals into touchdowns, but you know, sometimes it doesn't happen. The Chargers, the worst at 55%. Here are your red zone touchdown leaders, the Falcons, Patriots, Rams, Seahawks, Texans, and the Giants, all above 40. Looking at defensive red zone percentage, the Chiefs, the worst at 82%, and the Panthers, the best, surprisingly. They go 6-9-1, they were 61%. They allowed 37 of 60 allowed trips to score. Here's a look at the teams that allowed the most red zone trips, the Colts at 69%. And the Bears only allowed 25 teams to reach the end zone this season. It is very hard to score when you can't get to the red zone, especially when this team takes away the football 37 times in a season and only gives it away 22 times, which isn't great, but, you know, gotta take what you can get. We were plus 15, which is a pretty big improvement over years past, and the Falcons were plus 22. The Steelers, who surprisingly were our Super Bowl opponent, were minus 7. The team with the most giveaways, that goes to the Buccaneers at 33, and the least, there are the Falcons at 11. Buccaneers, 23 interceptions, tied with the Lions and Titans. Fumbles lost, the Raiders lead with 13. Your takeaway leader this year is the Chicago Bears, who should have 39, but this game can't do math. 26 plus 13 is 39, not 37. So, sorry, New England, you're in second place. That's going to do it for the team numbers. Let's look at career numbers. Mitchell Trubisky, they crossed 10,000 passing yards this year. 64 TDs, 33 interceptions, throwing 64% and 231 yards per game. Jordan Howard, nearly hitting the 4,500-yard mark this season, although his numbers obviously weren't super impactful because Freddie Finlis was the main show horse this year. Paul Richardson leads the team in yards. Cameron Meredith at 2,500 just crossed that mark, 15 touchdowns. Mark Barron, 507 tackles. Did not really play much this year outside of a few spots where people were injured and the backups came on the field. Adrian Amos leads the team in tackles for a loss through these past couple years with 31. Henry Wong, 27.5 sacks over two seasons. I hate that I can't spend more time with number 93. He's one of my favorite players in this series. Kyle Fuller, 17 career interceptions. A lot of those have come over the past 2 years. Fuller's also wrapped up quite a few defensive touchdowns coming via pick sixes, most of those against the Detroit Lions back in season two. Gonna miss causing issues for Matthew Stafford. TJ Cartwright over 2 years, 90%, 59 of 65. 90% average is not too bad. Pat O'Donnell these past couple years has also been pretty impressive. Those numbers very silky. On to coach statistics. Demetrius Turner, who has really turned this team around, 25 wins, 5 losses, 1 tie. Led this team to a 10-5-1 record last year, nearly made the postseason. Obviously 19-0 this year, so 2 winning seasons, 3 playoff wins, and 1 Super Bowl. Chris Hall, as an owner, we're moving in the right direction. Obviously, we've got some things that we would like to improve on. Here's an overall look at this offense as we are closing out this series. Maybe. Got a lot of really big pieces already in place. Got some other pieces that we obviously need to improve on. Contracts coming up this year. Who knows who's going to be here? Who knows who will be shipped off to the nether realm? Who knows? Let's look at some owner stuff. We haven't done this in quite some time. Team value, Chicago, 4th overall. Fan happiness obviously should be number 1 with that Super Bowl win. team success, we should be number one, but who cares? Popularity, who cares? Staff, second ranked in the league. Stadium obviously needs a little bit of work. Merchandise, we're selling pretty well. Second ranked in the league, and I thought it would be a little higher after winning the Super Bowl. Only $2.43 million in merchandise. I for sure thought we would be selling hats out the wazoo, but apparently we did not. Jerseys are, I mean, everything's reasonably priced, right? Everything's below average or market value. I thought we would be selling a ton of stuff, especially a lot of the Super Bowl merchandise. Freddie Finlay's jerseys selling well, so are Beasley or Beasley's. Howard is there as well, along with Trubisky and Collins. Kind of wish you could set the players that you wanted to have jerseys sold. Like, obviously, Henry Wong being a number one pick should be a marketable player, you would think. Personality rating, like, it never improves, and you're kind of just stuck with what you can get. Let's talk media questions. Obviously, this team was under a lot of scrutiny this year, and we got a lot of questions starting from the preseason, and we pretty much answered all these questions the right way, and we reached our goals for this season. Team popularity is our best thing going on right now, but our stadium is really, really bad, and it's time to pour some money into Soldier Field. A 16 rating right now. Everything is garbage. It's like $20 million in upgrade. We didn't move. I didn't want to rebuild the stadium, but obviously we're going to have to pour some money into getting this fixed. Here's a coaching staff to close things out. Demetrius Turner, Ray Woodall, and I think Trey Bradley are the staff right now. The scout's good, although I don't really think we need any more DBs, but you never know what could happen, and obviously regression is good where it is. So that, guys, will do it for this season recap for the Chicago Bears franchise. Things are closing out the right way, but is this the end of the road? Maybe, maybe not. Some people have wanted to see a sim, and the only reason I'm hesitant towards doing a sim is because this team wasn't built for simulating. I don't really put a lot of points into awareness ratings, which is really important for simming, and that could cause a lot of issues when it comes to simming, and obviously this team wouldn't be the same, but maybe that would be a fun thing to watch. Obviously, it's up to you guys. I know a lot of you would probably want to see it, so if you do, let me know down below in the comments section. Thank you guys so much for tuning in to what is more than likely not the final episode of the Chicago Bears franchise, if I know you guys as well as I think I do. I will see you guys, I guess, next month or sometime for a 5-year sim. We'll hopefully see this team win another Super Bowl with me not at the helm. Catch you guys then. See you later.